Hello and welcome to Latest TV. I'm Stephanie Pryor. Today I'm here with New York media and music legend Mark Riley, who's bringing culture and music to our city. Mark, welcome to Latest TV.
Thank you so much, Stephanie. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure to have you here today. Now, you've had such a successful career in media and music, but let's start with music. And let's go back to the 1970s, when I understand that you co-founded your first music business for the record.
Well, it wasn't really my business. It was an organization that my friend David Mancuso put together. Because disc jockeys all over the city were having difficulty accessing records, and in some instances they ended up having to go to record stores and pay for records.
Sure.
And it was a totally chaotic situation. So David decided to like bring everybody together and start this organization, and he brought in the record companies and he brought in the DJs and he kind of forged this pool, the New York record pool. And disc jockeys, eventually there were like 250 disc jockeys that were members. And they would come in once a week and they would pick up records. And the record companies, instead of having to worry about people being in their lobby all the time, they just sent us the music and we would distribute it evenly to everybody.
Sure.
And, you know, the disc jockeys would give feedback. Mm-hmm. They would say, you know, this record was great or this record stunk or whatever. And it worked very, very successfully, for a while. But then eventually, I think David kind of felt like the members were kind of taking advantage of him. They didn't, a lot of the newer members didn't really know the time and effort he put into putting it together and keeping it going.
Mm-hmm.
So eventually, he just got tired of it. I went down there a couple times to go to work and there were places locked down tight as a drum. It was like that through Christmas of 1977.
Mm-hmm.
And then early in 1978, a couple of the disc jockeys that were members of the pool came to Judy Weinstein, who ended up running it, myself, Hank Williams, and Larry Levan, and said, listen, why don't you guys, you know, start a pool?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm saying, I don't want to be bothered. I was working at the radio station. I didn't, you know, it wasn't one thing or the other for me. But Judy decided, you know, well, yeah, let's try it. Let's try and do it. So we got a space, and on February 2nd, 1978, For the Record was born. And it was smaller than the New York pool. We only had 125 members, and that was deliberate. So
right.
it didn't become unwieldy. And it survived for a very long time. It really survived right up until streaming began. I mean, they even gave out at one time CDs. But the streaming kind of killed it because you didn't need physical records anymore.
Sure.
But it was a really great experience for me.
Yeah.
I got to know a lot of very, very talented, very creative people who were spinning records at that time. Because we had everybody from Studio 54 to Xenon to all of these clubs. They all came there. And we got to know who the temperamental ones were and who the, you know. So it was a really great experience.
I bet. And you met loads of influential musicians, particularly with house, club, and music, from what I understand.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I met Ralph McDonald, who did Calypso Breakdown. Roy Ayers is still a friend of mine. And Roy, it's funny, because I first saw him when I was a teenager, when he was playing with Herbie Mann's group. And then, you know, he started listening to the program, and I interviewed him a couple of times. And we were over here one time, long before we moved, and we were in London at the hotel, and it turned out Roy was right down the street. So I called, and he didn't answer. He was busy or whatever. So I just left a message and told him Mark Riley called. So my wife, Kim, looked and said, you don't know Roy Ayers. What are you, crazy? You know? So I had gone in another room, and the phone rang. And Kim picked it up and walks in the other room, wide-eyed. It's Roy Ayers on the phone. And we went to see him at Ronnie Scott's.
Amazing.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, I got to know a fair number of musicians, a fair number of people. And I got to know what drives musicians.
Sure.
You know, and the people that really make music. Mm-hmm. It's changed over time because there's a lot more electronics involved.
Yeah.
But like I interviewed Ron Carter, who's one of the most fabulous bass players. And he's like, he just turned 85 years old and he's still recording. He's, I don't know how many thousand records he's put out.
Yeah.
But you know, you get a chance to meet people like that and it's priceless.
Sure.
It's absolutely priceless. I feel like really blessed or lucky or both. To have had the ability to do this over time.
Sure. And it's interesting and very, I'd say, intelligent as well that you used your music career to also support your media career. And you've been a very successful radio presenter for many years, starting off in New York, from what I understand.
Yeah.
And you interviewed some very influential people. When I Googled your name, a picture of yourself and Nelson Mandela came up.
Yeah, I spent a half hour with him. That was the high point of my radio career. Usually, I dealt with local New York City politics. I interviewed mayors and governors and, you know, people on the local political scene. And politics in New York is a lot like blood sport. You
sure.
know, people just, you know, you can tell there are certain people that they intent on destroying their enemies, not just beating them in an election, but destroying them.
Yeah.
But then when Mr. Mandela got out of prison, he came to New York. New York was the first place he came. And a very good friend of mine, Bill Lynch, rest in peace, was a deputy mayor at that time. And he calls me up. He says, listen, do you want to interview Mandela? I said, excuse me?
What? Yeah.
Yeah. And I said, of course. You know, so I went over to the UN Plaza Hotel, which is right next to the United Nations. That's where he was staying. And I spent a half hour with him. And it was extraordinary. The man said to me, with no irony in his voice, he says, apartheid is going to be gone in 4 years. I said, are you sure? Because apartheid had been in place for years and years before then. He had just gotten out of prison.
Yeah.
It only took three. And next thing you know, he's the president of the country. He was an amazing, amazing man. And the thing I didn't realize, I knew that he was a boxing aficionado and that he used to box before he went to prison. But he was in New York at a time when there was talk about having a second fight between Mike Tyson and Buster Douglas. Buster Douglas had beaten Tyson the first time.
Okay.
And Nelson Mandela asked everybody. He asked the janitors, he asked the wait staff, everybody in the hotel, do you think Mike Tyson could beat Buster Douglas in a rematch? And people are looking at him like, what, are you kidding me? You know, you're Nelson Mandela, you shouldn't have to care about something like that. But he's a wonderful, wonderful man.
I imagine him having quite a big aura in a room, like, you know, when he walks in,
yes.
you notice him.
Well, yeah, because first of all, he was an extraordinarily upright man. And he carried himself, you know, because his people came from royalty.
Sure.
They were, what do they call them? Socias, I think they call them. And he carried himself without being self-conscious about it. But he carried himself with this aura that just, people were just like, uh-oh. And then later on that same day, I ended up interviewing him in a studio downtown. And we talked about South African politics. We talked about some of the trade unions who were really the backbone of the anti-apartheid movement there. And a lot of people didn't know this at the time.
Yeah.
But I interviewed him. I interviewed Jean-Bertrand Aristide, who was the first democratically elected president of Haiti in like hundreds of years, and had a chance to sit with him. That was, we covered his inauguration, and the guy he beat in the election, I interviewed, a guy named Marc Bazin.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, the word was the Haitian treasury only had $92,000 in it or something. So I said to him, because he was a banker.
Sure.
So I said, listen, I've heard that there was only $92,000 left in the Haitian treasury. Do you know what happened to all that money? And his bodyguards pulled guns on me.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Not messing around.
No, but he said, no. And he answered the question.
Sure.
He was a very nice man. But they took their politics very, very seriously. You know.
That's really interesting.
Yeah, but it was, you know, I've had a nuanced life. When I was in Haiti, I had an extraordinary musician named Mano Charlemagne. We were in a meeting in somebody's office, and he pulls me to one side, and he says to me, listen, be very careful while you're here. You're being watched. Always assume that people are watching and seeing what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So just keep that in mind. And I'm like, wait a minute, I didn't do anything. What did I do?
Yeah.
But it was what it was.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't trade 15 seconds of that or 15 seconds of my own life with anybody else's lifetime. I really wouldn't.
Sure. I mean, to commentate on history and go to Haiti and see it for yourself and experience that, that is life-changing.
We were the first outlet to announce that he had been successfully inaugurated.
And
amazing. I'm talking about in the world at that point.
Yeah.
And CNN picked it up, and a couple of other national outlets picked it up. And it was a very proud moment for me.
I bet.
You know, very, very proud moment. I got to talk to him. Very humble man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I felt bad because I thought he could have done so much more with Haiti, but there was all this...
A lot of politics, a lot of nonsense
got in the way of that.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah.
And you've also interviewed former presidents of the United States, Bill Clinton, I understand.
Yeah.
And also Jesse Jackson as well. Like, these are huge people. I mean, that must have been an amazing experience.
Well, I used to talk to Jesse Jackson all the time. I mean, another stupid story. We were at the Levan Plaza Hotel in Washington for a conference. And I'm walking across the lobby. And here comes Jesse with his entourage, right? And he sees me and he freezes. And I'm looking like, what's going on? He says, Riley, you're dressed. I said, yeah, I'm dressed. Why not? I mean, I'm going to. Yeah, but you never dress. I said, yeah, Reverend, you know, every now and then, every now and then. You know, his wife is a lovely woman too. Jackie, really, really nice people. Every time I saw her at an event or whatever, protest, she was always wonderful to me. And so was Jesse. You know, he was always accessible to me.
Well, it sounds like you've got some great friends and people that you've met over time.
Yeah.
And moving forward to today, so you've recently moved to Brighton.
I have.
And you live here with your wife, Kim Riley, who I know and is a lovely lady.
Sure, she's a keeper.
She definitely is. And you both come across as such a strong couple as well, which is really inspiring to see. But you've set up a business in Brighton, Parlor Sessions.
Parlor Sessions, and I mean, I've actually managed to keep myself much busier here than I thought I was gonna, you know, because I retired before I came over here. And, you know, one thing has led to another thing, has led to another thing. And I'm doing these parlor sessions, which is, the first one was just mixing whiskey and jazz. Because I thought they went well together. And we haven't set a second one yet. And it may not be jazz, but we're in the process of setting that up. And I'm doing a podcast every week. It's Mark Riley Media, I think it's called. I don't know. It's called The Intersection. That much I do know. And we talk about American politics from the perspective of being over here. And then I do a weekly radio show. But it's a music. It's the first time I've really done an on-air music show. I mean, I've been at this since 1973, but this is the first time I have ever done a music radio show. Not far from here, at Brighton & Hove Community Radio.
And that's every Wednesday?
Wednesday at 3 o'clock, yeah.
So I'll definitely be checking that out. And your podcast as well. Where can we find more information about and check into your podcast, Mark?
You can reach it. It's on a lot of different platforms, but it's also on my website, Mark Riley Media.
Brilliant.
MarkRileyMedia.com. The music is just on Mark Riley Media because it goes up on Mixcloud.
Sure.
You know, like to keep busy.
I know. Well, when you said that you were retired, I was thinking, really? And just going back to your whiskey and jazz nights. So the idea of that, I suppose, is that people, like businesses, for example, could contact you and hire in your services.
I mean, the first one we did with Sebastian Wolf, Seb is a wonderful guy, and he has a whiskey bar over in the North Lane called Cut Your Wolf Loose. And I was over there, Kim had gotten me a ticket to a whiskey tasting, and Seb and I got talking, and I said, you know, it'd really be interesting to try and pair whiskey and jazz. He caught on to the idea, and it turned out really, really successful. I was really surprised. And I mean, I didn't do a lot of whiskey for a long time, but I did it. I started doing it when I started smoking cigars. And Kim went on a, 20, 25 year quest to get me to quit. And when I came over here, I actually did quit. But I really do love the taste of Scotch whiskey. It's lovely.
It's very strong.
Yeah.
But for me.
But I mean, I don't, you know, I put a definite cap on what I drink.
Sure.
You know, it's like maybe, what do they call it? A wee dram over here. I do that and not much more.
Sure.
You know, because I don't like to be drunk. That's not in my DNA.
Yeah.
So, you know, I do that and I'll go over there periodically.
Sure.
And I did the parlor session and ended up getting a bottle of whiskey from that. And it's enjoyable. I really enjoy, first of all, I absolutely, without conditions, love music. I really do. When I first started working in radio, my first attempt was at doing radio, which I had a lot of misconceptions about, but hey, what are you gonna do? And I said to the guy that interviewed me, you know, we talked about music, we talked about, you know, Stevie Wonder and all these people who were just coming into their ascendancy. This is 1973. And then at the end of the conversation, he said to me, well, I'm the news director. I can't really do anything for you as far as music is concerned. That's not my area. But have you ever thought about doing news? Now, before I went, my older brother, my brother Clayton, rest in peace, said to me, no matter what they say to you, don't say no. So when this guy said to me, have you ever thought about doing news? I said, no, but I'll do it, you know. And 2 days later, I started interning. And the rest is history. That's how I started.
And what a successful career that you've had. But just going back to the wine, the whiskey and jazz. So I know that you don't have a date set for your next one, but when I recently caught up with Kim, she mentioned that there's a potential for one to take place in September.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
For more information about that, I suppose we should follow your social media pages.
I'm the worst social media person God ever put out.
Well, don't worry, I'm following you and your Mark Riley Media. So.
Yeah.
Do follow Mark if you'd like more information about his jazz and whiskey nights. I will definitely be aiming to attend the next one because I saw
it. May not be jazz next time.
Okay.
It might be house music. It might be classical. I love all kinds of music.
You're bringing culture and music together.
Yes, definitely.
It sounds great. Well, Mark, it's been an absolute pleasure to catch up with you today.
This has been an honor talking to you, Stephanie.
Thank you. And I could literally talk to you all day. We'll have to catch up again sometime because you've got some amazing stories. So thank you.
Thank you.